I think it's fitting that Laura's here from espnW on the day after the Boston College women's ice hockey team ranked number one in the country, the first time in the history of Boston College that a women's team has ever been ranked number one. And so for that, we're thrilled. Woo! Please. Woo! Laura has brought a sizzle reel, which I'm going to show to get things started and to get you guys in the right frame of mind. So let me turn up the volume, turn off the lights. All right, lock.
I'm very proud to be here announcing this, a new collaboration between the State Department and espnW. It's called the Global Sports Mentoring Program.
I've seen that a couple of times now, and I get excited every time I see it. You lived it. You were the founder for espnW. Other than pride, how does that make you feel every time you see it?
I think it just shows how many amazing accomplishments women are making in the sports world. So it gets me fired up. I mean, we have a woman on our team, Sarah Spain, who's one of our lead writers, and she watches that, and she says, I want to go wrestle a bear. So I feel enormous pride, but I think it also just speaks to the impact women are having. What the future holds. Because if that's only 5 years, you know, when we are now 10, 20 years out, it's going to be even more incredible, I think.
So why does ESPN need W, and why does society need ESPN W?
Well, things are changing. I mean, you know, you look at the trend line ever since the passage of Title IX in 1972, 40 years ago, and girls are growing up playing sports, and it's our birthright, and it's not a guy's thing anymore. societal changes around what sports means and who can participate in sports is very different. So on some level, it's just making sports much more inclusive to say women have a right at the table. But I think as, you know, as you're here at the Carroll School, it just makes good business sense to be including women as a key target market. And that's something we talked about, you know, espnW. It's the right thing to do to start this business, but it's also a great business sense to start this business and to reach a larger market of sports fans.
I think that espnW has played a role in the answering the question, why do sports matter? How many of you played sports growing up or continue to play sports? Raise your hand. Sports teaches transformative skills that Professor Lemon and I and others can't recreate in the classroom. Right? They teach you dedication, leadership, commitment, and teamwork in ways that you can't do in a business case. And that those opportunities are part of what brings success in your future. The study that was conducted, 94% of C-suite women played sports at some point. Talk a little bit about what your vision was for espnW in terms of when you started out making the investment of creating this. What was your vision and have you gotten there yet?
We haven't gotten there yet because we're still having a lot of conversations where we're still convincing people that women matter, that women have a voice. And you know, the domestic violence issue in the NFL this past year, I think, opened a lot of eyes in terms of how the NFL handled that issue. And perhaps it would have been different if they had more senior executive women at the table deciding on that issue. So as those things continue to happen, our vision is not complete, and I think it's going to take some time. I mean, it's an evolutionary process. And to really look at women as equals in the sports world will take time. I mean, even if you just look at the ESPN executive ranks, our CFO is a woman, Christine Dreesen, and she's an incredible role model and a great mentor, but she's our only female EVP. And we have a lot of women in middle management, you know, the director level, the senior director level, the vice president level. It's going to take time. It's going to take a good 10 years at the very least until it's more equitable. So the business vision for ESPNW was really just getting started. In terms of we're 5 years in, we're a healthy business, our ESPNW summit is profitable, but we want to be a much more significant part of ESPN. And then the cultural change, I think you all feel it, but we're not there yet. So it's still a total work in progress.
So talk a little bit about this summit that ESPNW hosts and runs, and a little bit about the impact that it's having, not just nationally, but internationally.
Yeah, I mean, we started the ESPNW Summit 5 years ago, and at the time, we called it the ESPNW Retreat, and it was a way to launch the business. So when you think about how do we bring our brand to life in the most impactful way, we felt like the best thing to do was to throw an event that would bring the influencers and the sports world together and really bring our brand vision to life. So we tried to create the anti-conference. You know, we've all been to conferences, I think probably been to conferences where you sit passively and you listen to speakers drone on and you eat a bunch of buffet food and by the end of it you don't feel so great. And maybe you haven't even met another person at the conference. This was meant to sort of break down a lot of those barriers where we start every day with physical activity. So we have yoga, we have Navy SEAL boot camp, we have surf camps, we have meditation if you want to do that. But really ingrained physical activity in the entire conference. And that also serves not only the purpose of saying ESPNW is about you being empowered by your own body, but it also breaks down barriers where you're working out with conference attendees and you're cycling next to somebody and you start talking to them. And so we see it really, really positioning our business in an interesting way where we're creating a one sort of the industry standard when it comes to a women's conference, and it's also gathering the most influential people in the space. So we had the commissioner of the LPGA, the president of the WTA, Maria Shriver came this year, Gloria Allred came this year to talk about domestic violence. And it's really more in filling a void. You know, there's so many conferences in the sports world, you know, analytics, concessions, ticketing facilities. And until 5 years ago, there was no space for women to gather and women and men to gather who care about women in sports. So it's important for us. It also, I think, showed internally. You know, whenever you're trying to do something new in a company, you you get a lot of pushback, you know, around, we've never done that before. Or ESPN doesn't do conferences. And so we use this as an opportunity to say, well, we can, we certainly can. And I think we've shown a lot of people that you bring really interesting speakers and a real interesting format, and you bring it to a great location, and you can start changing minds and actually creating a network of people who care about the women's sports space.
It seems to me that the ESPNW has two purposes. You've got one, which is you've got your customer segment, where you're trying to attract more women, and having people engage with ESPN, which is a multi-billion dollar a year business. But you also have this more larger concern where you want to grow that marketplace and empower women, but also specifically young women who are coming up to then take the role of that 18 to 49 segment. Is that a fair assessment?
It is, and it's an interesting balance because it's not something at ESPN that we've done before. I mean, we're really looking at the purity of sports in a way that's a little bit different. You know, when you talk about women's sports, we don't have the big four leagues. You know, we don't have the superstars like LeBron that you could just telecast all day long and get ratings and viewers. We really looked at the space, and women care about a lot of things. They care about Ray Rice. They care about the NFL. They care about the World Series. But they also care about sports they played growing up, and they want to see those athletes and those sports in the spotlight more. They care about physical health and wellness, and how do I create that next goal for myself, and how do I achieve more. They're looking for inspiration. We do a lot of like inspirational quotes every day. And that's like a clean differentiator for ESPN.com. You would never see an inspirational quote on ESPN.com, but it's something that resonates really well with our audience. And we also do a lot of storytelling, you know, people's journeys, you know, how Brittany Griner got to be where she is, what makes Skylar Diggins unique. And we really try to get, you know, inside people and really understand who they are. Abby Wambach, why is she such a great figure within the soccer space? So we do a combination of a lot of things, and we're very, very inclusive when it comes to how women define sports.
Can you tell me a little bit about the demographics, both for ESPN, ESPN.com, and ESPNW in terms of the gender breakdown?
Yeah, I mean, when you look at the viewing audience of ESPN at large, it's 65% male and 35% women. So the 35% might be more or larger than you thought, and it actually turns out to be close to 25 million. In any given month, so it's significant. And that's part of W, is like we've opened people's eyes to, you know what, ESPN delivers a lot of women. We deliver more women than Lifetime, if that's something to be proud of, I don't know. But that's opened people's eyes to say, women have always loved sports. Now we're just putting a brand on it, now we're just putting more of a face on it. But the interesting part is, even though 65% of the ESPN audience is male, they do 80% of the viewing. And for a long time, that meant to our research department, well, men are avid, they do all the viewing, that's who we should care about. As opposed to seeing that there's upside with women only doing 18% of the viewing. So, you know, data is data. You can interpret it in a lot of different ways. Our internally, we've interpreted that as men are kind of really who matter, 18 to 49, in terms of the core audience. Whereas we've looked at it with the ESPNW to say, there's nothing but upside with getting women to watch more and to care more and to really, you know, connect with the brand in a bigger way.
And how are the demographics on the ESPNW website itself?
It's the inverse. It's 40%, well, it's actually similar. It's 40% women and 60% male. And a lot of that is because every time we post a story on ESPN.com, we get an avalanche of men coming over, which I think over time, that's fine with us. You know, when we were starting, you know, it was very much, you know, we were trying to attract this new audience and retain this new audience. I think now we just really want to do quality storytelling and quality journalism, and it's open for everybody. It's a little bit like the 9 for 9 films that we did, which is, we hope everybody's tuning into those. And it's not just about, you know, women only, even though that's who our target audience really is. It's a complicated mix, and it's why our company hasn't really focused on women for decades, because we have this avid group of men. So let's super serve those fans, as opposed to looking for opportunities with a group that perhaps is engaged, but not as engaged as they could be.
what is it that, and I'm conscious, I want to turn this over to the audience for a live Q&A, because I've got my question, but I think it's important that you guys have a chance to speak with Laura and ask her some questions. But what is it, I don't care about what happened at Duke, I do care about what it, being an athlete teach you and give you in terms of perspective to being now a tremendously successful businessman. What did being an athlete and an All-American?
There's a lot of things, which I think you all probably know that. But I mean, one is just adversity. I mean, not everything goes your way when you're playing. Whether it's younger and you get cut from a team, or you don't make the team you want to make, or you don't reach your goals as an individual or a team along the way, to just the difficulties of being on a team every day and managing those personalities and getting that chemistry right. So I think overcoming adversity is obviously always important, because you face a lot of that in the work world, where there's only certain things you can control and a lot of other things that you have to roll with. But certainly from a leadership and a team perspective, those are two huge lessons that I learned. You know, just what it means to be a teammate. Some people are just not good teammates. You know, and everybody has their role on the team. Some are leaders, some are followers, and you need really good followers too. So I think it's helped me as I've run this business and built this business to really be tuned in to the roles that everybody plays and what that means. And then what does it mean to be a leader? Not everybody has to be the rah-rah type, but you gotta stand up and make the tough decisions and be comfortable with that and be comfortable with consequences. So I mean, I could go on and on. I mean, there's so many parallels between being on a team and in business, which is, I think, why I went into business, is I just love that whole dynamic.
And what lessons did you learn here at Boston College's Carroll School?
Well, I was pretty young when I went to Carroll School. I went right from undergraduate to graduate. So one big thing was just maturity. You know, how to carry yourself and how to work with people who have more experience than you and who are older than you. And again, kind of fit in your role, you know, and how can you help a team work on an accounting project? How to help a team work on a marketing project? But I thought the marketing classes I took were super helpful. I mean, that's where it really punctuated my interest in marketing. I did an internship at Hill Holiday, but besides that, really focusing on marketing here just validated for me that that's what I wanted to do. And then I also got into organizational behavior classes, which I loved, because I think the team part of it and the leadership part of it. So those aspects were great.
And
also, I was an RA in the mods. Which I was so naive. I was just trying to pay my bills, right? So I was like, oh, let me apply to be an RA. And I got this letter, and my roommate was in the room when I got this letter and says, congratulations, you are an RA in the mods. And I was like, I don't even know what that is. And she's like, oh boy. So I was an RA in the mods for a year.
I did not know that. I would have definitely had a whole bunch of other questions for you. Last question for me at this point. Tell me how Hillary Clinton came into espnW's life.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. You know, it's a lesson in you never know who's watching. And not that she was watching us particularly closely, but her team was. And her team was briefing her on, like, who was doing really good things in the sports world and in sports media. And she has this platform about empowering women and girls through sports. And she's been an avid proponent of that for at least the last 5 years. She really feels like sports fits into diplomacy in a way that other things don't, and it brings people together in a way that other things don't. And so they were interested in starting a global sports mentoring program, and they needed a media partner, and they wanted a media partner. And this woman, Tally Sargent, on her team called us up and said, you know, we've been watching ESPNW, we've been watching you grow. We'd love to talk to you about being a media partner for us for the global sports mentoring program. And me, it was like, I'm in. But of course, I had to get buy-in in the executive ranks, because again, it's just something ESPN doesn't do. We don't partner with the State Department, and we don't necessarily get behind global mentoring programs, even though we could. It's just something we hadn't done before. And I remember talking to a lot of executives, and some of them were like, is this really a good use of your time? You're trying to build this business. Other people were like, well, this could be really politicized, because now you're aligning yourself with the Clintons. And I'm like, well, it's really not about that. It's really about taking this opportunity to work with women from around the world and bring them to the United States and have them learn from female executives in this country. And it was a really interesting, novel idea that it took people a while to get their heads around it. But they had us to the State Department. We met Hillary Clinton and the secretary. She was, you know, really gracious and wonderful. And it's going on year three, and we've now had 50 women coming through the program. And when I say mentees, these are 25 to 40-year-old women who apply through their embassy, the U.S. embassy in their country, and they say, I want to come to the United States for 4 months. And some people have, most of these women have never been to the United States before. And for some of them, it's a huge, you know, it's a huge leap of faith in our country, and also a statement of courage on their part. I mean, we have women from Pakistan, Zimbabwe, from Kenya, truly international, and some of them don't come from great situations where it's truly hard to be a female journalist, let alone a female sports journalist. And coming here means a lot, and they learn a lot. And the interesting thing is the executives. We have like Gatorade, New Balance, Under Armour, the WNBA, the WTA, they're all partners of ours who host these women for a month. These executives invariably learn as much, if not more, than these women. Take things for granted in our country, you know, that we have women on the table, we have a voice, and these women just impart a lot of lessons on us, too.
That's great. I'm going to open it up for questions in the audience. I hope you stand up and speak loudly so we can hear you.
By the way, I want to introduce my sister, Susan, my son, Will, and my nephew, Theo.
Welcome.
Thank you so much. We have a generous guest here.
Don't think they start calling you. Come.
Hello. Hi, Mary Lou. My name is Ty Thomas. I'm a junior in AMS. And I'm a filmmaker, so I love the black and white you guys have going on. So if you could talk a little bit about the process of choosing the director, where did that idea come from?
Yeah, you know, it's really awesome. We did a huge initiative around the 40th anniversary of Title IX back in 2012. And as you know, films don't happen overnight. So it was when we were figuring out how big to make our 40th anniversary celebration, we said, gosh, this is the perfect opportunity to do 9 films for Title IX, but it takes a year and a half to make a great film. So we kept that celebration going on into 2013, but it really started when we planned for the 40th anniversary of Title IX, and we said, hey, we should really have these films all directed by women, and really put the tools and the camera and all the sort of supervisory direction in the hands of women. And it was interesting because our 30 for 30 films are super popular, as you all know, and resonate with a lot of people. But it caused us to go back and look, and believe it or not, out of the 52 30 for 30s we've done, only 4 were about women or directed by women. So we were like, okay, that's a dynamic we gotta change. And so we did 9 films by women, about women. And we used a lot of independent filmmakers who really pitched us on their idea. And we didn't hold too fast to the constraint that it had to be about Title IX. It was more, what are the best stories that illustrate just the dynamics that are going on around women in sports, that they're all inspired by Title IX, but they're not directly connected to Title IX. So it was everything from, you know, female journalists gaining access to the locker room and the fight that went on there where females didn't have access to the locker room after games. And it's like, how do you do your job? How do you cover a team if you can't get into the locker room and you only talk to players 2 hours after a game when all the emotion has worn off? So it's everything from journalism to we chronicled the 1999 World Cup team and looked at how that team evolved and the leadership of that team. We looked at Pat Summit. I think the biggest takeaway from that was opening people's eyes, that female filmmakers have a place on ESPN and that everybody will tune in to those stories. We're not just women.
Question.
We grow more across our television networks. As you know, we have 6 television networks already that are fully distributed. And so we want to get our brand more integrated across that. So whether that's in women's sports, where you start seeing espnW segments and storytelling within WNBA games, or women's college games, or women's college soccer games, to our own unique programming. So the 9-round films are an example of original storytelling that we want to do more of. And we also want to create more studio shows that are W-centric. So we continue to grow on the digital side, but for the next few years, our growth is really going to be looking at TV programming. In addition to just on the ESPN networks, we are owned by the Walt Disney Company, ESPN is, and so there's so much opportunity to open the eyes of folks within the Walt Disney Company to the connection between women, girls, and sports. So we talked to the Disney Channel folks, we talked to ABC Family, we talked to the ABC Broadcast Network folks, and little by little, they're starting to see that there is a greater connection between girls and sports. So ideally, you just start seeing sort of more programming and more influence of ESPN across those channels. But it's a huge opportunity for us. I mean, we all know the reach of Walt Disney Company is extraordinary. So if we can get them to start thinking about sports and women go together, that's a big opportunity. That and becoming
awesome. And giving it all back to Boston College now,
yeah,
too.
There you go.
Excellent. Professor?
Sure, I'll ask a question. Laura, as you think about if you were in your second or if you were a sophomore, junior, or senior, right, now, what things would you recommend that, you know, think about what would you recommend that students do to prepare themselves for a career in journalism or in marketing? What do you think they should do while they're on campus? What should they do inside the classroom, outside the classroom?
I think as much sort of real world experience as possible. You know, I was so fixated on field hockey and my athletic goals as an undergraduate, and I always did well in the classroom, but I sort of woke up my senior year like, oh gosh, what's next? You know, there's not a huge professional career in field hockey. So, you know, it was sort of putting that on fast forward, which was internships. And how do I get real world experience? And that's really important because I think it helps you validate the path you want to take, you know, working in those industries. And then second of all, I think it helps you stand out because you just have a leg up on people by saying, you know, I've experienced, you know, advertising agencies, or I've experienced a law firm. But I think the biggest thing is continue to figure out how you stand out. I think there's a tendency, I think, now for students to send their resumes and kind of then leave it in your hands to call them back or to schedule a call with them. And it's not going to work in the, you know, in the executive ranks. Everyone's just so, so busy. So how do you stand out? Like, how do you not just send a resume, but how do you send a reel of your work? Or how do you send a portfolio? Or how do you just show that you're different than the next candidate? And it's so much more than a resume. A resume is just the basics. But how do you establish, you know, if you're a filmmaker, like, how do you send a reel to somebody to say, this is what I've already done, and I'm only an undergraduate. Or this is what I've already done, and I'm only first year in graduate school. It's really hard to stand out, but
you've
got to figure out a way to do it as creative as you
can
possibly be.
Let me ask or layer on another component of that, which is, you're in the sports industry. Mm-hmm. You're a woman in the sports industry. How important was it for you to identify mentors, both men and women, to help you in realizing your passion and your dream in getting the ESPNW Lawrence as critical as it is?
It's super important now, but, you know, I think when you're young and you're coming up the ranks, you're not fully aware of all that and all those dynamics. But I would say if you can recognize that as early as possible, you're better off. I mean, now I see it in spades, right? Our former president, George Bodenheimer, I worked with him extremely closely. You know, he helped me get W off the ground, not by propelling it, but by just giving me the opportunity to spend time on it and focus on it. And Christine Dreesen, who I mentioned, our CFO, you know, she really takes it as a point of pride to help the women in our company to kind of figure out their path and what next. So I would say in hindsight, I didn't do it myself, but in hindsight, figure out those people who you admire and who you respect and spend a little bit more time with them, or get them to spend a little bit more time with you. And sometimes a mentor word is so loaded, like you think it has to be this icon, this president of a company. It could be a colleague who has, an extra year of experience, or a colleague who just knows stuff that you don't know. Because I think sometimes you get thinking, I don't know, have a mentor because you have it on such a pedestal, but it's just somebody who can help you in your career. But it's super important, because that's how the world works, and certainly how the business world works. It's all relationships. And I think about being at ESPN for 7 years before I started ESPNW. The only way to have started it was to be an insider. Get to know who's who, and who the executives were going to be that supported it, and who the executive were that weren't going to support it. So steer clear. Steer clear of them for a while until you've got your idea really crystallized. And who are the executives that are on the fence that with a little bit more data or a push or ideas could come your way? So it's all about navigating those situations and having those relationships.
More questions from the audience?
My name is Brian. I was kind of wondering how your competitors kind of reacted to really identifying more of a niche market compared to what other sports networks really focus on.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting. Because I feel like CBS, now that they've started a women's show on Tuesday nights, I feel like they're drinking the Kool-Aid a little bit, and they got a lot of great press for their show, so I think that's a good sign. I've talked to different industry types. I've been so focused on just building what we're building that I haven't really taken that kind of a poll. But I have been hearing that there are competitors out there who feel like they're just so far ahead of where they're at. With our research, we've done so much research on this market and young girls' passion for sports and women who already use ESPN and their passion for sports and women who don't use ESPN. So we have so much research. I think that alone is maybe different than a lot of our competitors. And then we have really enlightened, without sounding pejorative, like enlightened executives, in that they understand that to have the most high quality content, you need diverse people in the decision making ranks. And so ESPN really is committed to diverse thinking. And I'm not sure everybody in the sports industry is that committed as, John Skipper, our current president, is. And so it feels like we are pretty far along, although on some level, even though I want to win and can't be number one, it actually is a little disappointing, because women plus sports is so obvious and it's such a big market. But I actually, on some level, wish more people kind of recognize the opportunity.
More people at ESPN,
just in the marketplace. We talk to a lot of clients. Under Armour's buying in, Gatorade's buying in, Toyota's buying in. But for every one of those, there's three people who are still not quite sure that women talk sports and women like sports, and that's a passion point. They feel so much more comfortable talking to women about fashion and beauty and entertainment and sort of the tried and true. And I think they will realize over time that women are so passionate about sports, and being an athlete is so ingrained that it's the perfect way to talk to women. But there's definitely people as in the marketplace, executives, and media executives who are still hesitant.
More questions?
Hi, full-time members.
To 100, but it's 30. We're dedicated week in and week out. number, but you know, it would be a lot more significant.
I'm just wondering, after having spent so many years at UCLA, what was your vision that sort of inspired you to actually do this position?
Well, I think as an individual, you know, you always want to feel like you're making your mark, right, and you're making a difference in your training. But for me, it was pretty obvious. I mean, at the time, I worked directly with our president, who at the time was George Loewenheimer, and it was a great role because I was chief of staff, and I could see all our financial planning for the next 10 years, and what we were reporting to the Walt Disney Company. And I could see that, you know, we were making the majority of our money with the eyes of our core audience of men 18 to 49. And I just felt like there was such an opportunity to look at sports fans more broadly than that. And recognizing that our ad sales group literally sends a, you know, sells $1 billion worth of advertising against ESPN properties. And out of that, it was probably $50,000 that went against women. Like, it was just kind of a non-existent conversation about how do you sell women through ESPN. So for me, it was a fairly obvious business opportunity in that, gosh, we don't have a strategy against women. And if we're gonna be as powerful and as successful as we are 20 years from now, we have to think about new audience growth. We have to think about kids, we have to think about teens, we have to think about women. And then having, you know, I guess the background that I have, and I know that there's so many women out there who love sports and who have grown up playing sports, just intuitively it made sense as well. And that's what we did. We kind of proved the business case that this was a big audience to be served, but we also had a lot of research that showed, you know, the greater appetite for girls in sports and the greater passion girls in sports and the greater participation, that at some point this was going to tip into more viewership and more usage.
Last question.
I was just curious how much of you grow and like what percentage of your viewership and revenue it now comes from women.
It's still not what it, you know, it still is not what it can be. I mean, it's, we're now, and this is off the record or whatever, you know, we were zero when we started and we're now at $10 million. And ideally we'll be, you know, the goal is to be a $50 million business within the next 5 years. So in the grand scheme of ESPN economics, it's still not a huge business, but it just shows sort of the tip of the iceberg that if we pay attention, we can really make some money here, and it's just an important audience to be served, more importantly.
So for a non-financial question, I'll ask this last question. We'll come back here in 10 years. It'll be the 50th anniversary of Title IX. ESPNW will be in year 15. We saw in this sizzle reel, we saw USA Soccer, we saw Melanie Davis, we saw women's basketball. What is it, we saw Hillary Clinton. What is it that you'll be showing us in your sizzle reel when you come back in 10 years?
Well, there'll be a female president of the United States. And there'll be a female president of ESPN. I think, you know, I'm being facetious a little bit, but I think those two things are coming. I don't know if it's going to be in 10 years, but I just think it's more having a seat at the table and having a bigger voice in the sports world and women's concerns being front and center and more female athletes in the spotlight. I think that's the biggest thing for me. I think having been an athlete and been a field hockey player where you were psyched if there were 30 people at your games and 28 of them were parents. Like, you know how hard you work, especially at a Division I level. And there's incredible stories from those female athletes. And so, you know, it's not so much we want more female athletes, you know, featured on SportsCenter next to LeBron, but more than there is now, you know, significantly more coverage and significantly more exposure and hopefully more successful professional leagues. Like, ideally we have a very successful national soccer league in this country for women. That's really important. I feel like the WNBA's viewership has doubled by then. So I feel like on every measure, it's just more growth and more exposure.
And maybe one of those two will be president Gentile when you come back?
I don't know.
On behalf of Boston College, the Carroll School, the marketing department, students in your alma mater, thank you so much for coming back.